We are fortunate to have two colleagues from the National Institute for Demographic Research from Paris, who have worked together and indeed in conjunction with other scholars whose work will also be reflected in their presentations. I will first ask Professor Dr. Jacques Vallin to speak about the crisis of the 1930s.
Thank you.
Okay, it will be okay in a few minutes. But I don't see why this. Okay. Thank you. Well, I think that my presentation and that of France Mesle will be rather different from the previous one because we are not historian, but we are only statisticians and demographers. And also we use some language which is not necessarily very familiar to you. So we will try to be as simple as possible and also to try to solve a very big question about this Holodomor. What is the magnitude of it? As it was said yesterday, it's important to look at the magnitude of each event like that. And our work is only that. How many people was suffering of that, and how many people would die? Okay, so my presentation will be just a summary of a chapter in that book devoted to mortality and cause of death in Ukraine during the 20th century. With a special effort about past crisis. And my presentation will be only one chapter of this book. And this book is in French, unfortunately, but an Ukrainian version of the book has just been published by the National Institute for Demographic Research in Kiev. And also we to publish it in English rather soon. But if you would like to have the book, it is possible to ask us for a copy. So, what was the immediate consequences of the Great Famine in Ukraine in 1933? There are different authors who tried already to do something about it. We are not the first, of course. Many people thought about that before us. And I mentioned here Sergei Matsudov, of course, Sergei Piroshkov, but there is also Kulchitsky, who is there, I think, who did something about it. But all these attempts are first attempt to measure the whole, to measure the whole results of the famine, but there are two problems there. The first one is that the global approach does not allow us to distinguish between the effect of decline of fertility, the effect of rising mortality and migration. And also, some of the authors, especially Sergei Piroshkov, for example, use modeling. And modeling is something sometimes misleading. And in that case, it seems to us that the results are exaggerated by modeling. So we tried to do the things rather differently. And the aim for us is not only to estimate the global losses due to the famine, but also to disentangle respective effects of birth deficit, crisis, excess mortality, and net out migration. And the method is to use as far as possible all existing data. Of course, we cannot use archive data like you present them, but at least as far as possible, all statistical archive data. And just to criticize the data and to find ways to correct them and to try to interpret the global results. Of course, it is interesting to do that because we have some information which is very important. For example, you can see here the trends in births, in deaths for males and females during the year 20s and 30s. And you can see, obviously, that there is something, even through the official official archive data, there is something very clear. There is a very big crisis in terms of deaths and in terms of births. So we think that it is important to take in account their data and what they give us to eventually correct them, but also to take in account what they say. So we first, as any other author before us, we first estimate global losses by just comparing the 1939 census to the 1926 census. We have population census by sex and age, and it is possible to make comparison by generation, by cohort. So we can do that, and we can also use for making comparison different projection of population based on different sort of fertility and mortality rates. Of course, normal mortality is an objective for us, because what would have been the population in 1939 without crisis, with normal mortality, with normal fertility? And doing that, we can estimate the global losses. So the starting point is population censuses. And for example, here you have the 26 age pyramid from the census. And you can see that, as it was said, it gives some good shape of the statistics. Of course, there are problems. There are problems. Even for this census, which is a very good quality, as you said, there are problems, but usual problems. As in the States, for example, in the beginning of the 20th century, you have this heaping phenomenon, age heaping phenomenon, which is in orange here, and we have to make some adjustment to take in account of the problem. The problem is that the age is not very well known when you make the census, and people tend to announce a round age. So we have this type of things. And for the next census, 1939, there is the same problem, but less, because things are going better. So the only thing we did there was to make a proper pyramid without HEP. And it is true that for the 1939 census, a lot of discussion appeared about the quality of the census because of the rejecting the census of 1937 and the Stalinist view on statistics and so on. But in fact, even if on the time some global results were falsified, in fact, in archive, you have the truth. So many demographers today, there's data, and they said that it is normal quality. It is not falsified at all at that level. So we can work with that. And to work with that, we have to make an hypothesis about the normal mortality between 1926 to 1939. And to do that, we have also there, we have some data in archives, some data, and some of them was published, life table for this two period, 1926-27, 1938-39. And these data are not perfect, of course, and we corrected them because there are some problem with the estimation of infant mortality, for example, and also with the mortality at older ages. But as usual, it is not so bad data. There are data like you have for other countries at the same time. And we can manage with that. We can make some better estimation from the data. And we get these two curves, the blue one for the first period and the red one for the last period. And our hypothesis is very simple. If there is no there is no crisis in Ukraine for the time, we should have observed slowly decreasing mortality like in other countries between these two curves. So we draw lines for each age to get specific mortality by age during each year for the period. And for fertility, it's more difficult to make a very precise hypothesis. It is more difficult because if you look at the birth register, the green line, we see that there is a very big problem with the crisis of the famine. The fertility fell down, of course. But when you look at the trends before the crisis, it seems that Ukraine started as in any country of the Eastern Europe at the time, started a decrease in the fertility, a long-term decrease of fertility. And then we could have expected continuation of this decreasing trend to go to the modern step of the fertility transition. But some event impeach that is the forbidden of abortion after the famine. During the year, I don't remember the year, but in the year 2000, no, the year 36, abortion was forbidden. So there was a jump in fertility after the crisis, which is not only a recuperation effect, it is also the effect of the abortion, the forbidden abortion. And so it is necessary to take that in account. And we draw this red line in dots. Huh? But this is less solid, perhaps, than for mortality, but it is an acceptable hypothesis. Because our view is that with or without famine, probably the abortion would have been forbidden. We don't know, but it would be possible. So we take this hypothesis, and then, according to this hypothesis, we made a projection of population from 26 to 39, and we found a total population of 35.5 million expected in 1933, instead of 30.9. So 4,600,000 are missing. This is an estimation of the global losses for the crisis. How to disentangle global losses into specific effects of birth deficit, excess mortality, and migration? This is more difficult. But we tried to do it by doing first a second projection without with actual fertility rates. Actual fertility rates for calculated after correction of birth registration and so on. But with actual fertility rates and by estimating migration deficit from registered data and the specialized literature. Okay. So we observed a population in 1926 census by age and sex to 29 million person. Actual evolution give for 1939 an observed population of 30.9. Okay? If we do a projection with fertility without crisis and mortality without crisis and no migration, we get an expected population of 35.5. So it means that the total loss, as we already said, are 4.6. Thus, we do a second projection with actual fertility and mortality without crisis and no migration, and we get an expected population of 34.5, which means that the birth deficit, the part of the 4.6 due to birth deficit is 1.1. And then we have to manage with migration and to estimate the net migration effect. We estimated it at 0.9. It's a long way to explain how we did that, but in fact we looked deeply at to the literature about it, and we used mainly the work of Zemkov, and it is true that we know a lot of things, not very clear, so very often it is disparate, but many things are known about forced migration. Because the Soviet took registration of everything. So we can have some good estimation of forced migration. Our problem was with free migration. But weighting the pro and the contra, it seems to us that it is better to make an hypothesis of negligible free migration. In fact, it was so difficult at the time to migrate in Ukraine and even more outside of Ukraine that the probable better estimation is to take zero free migration, but a lot of forced migration, which are estimated here to 0.9. And finally, our estimation for the crisis mortality effect is 2.6 million. It seems to us that the Holodomor killed directly by famine 2,600,000 people in Ukraine, which is a lot. And then we tried to, from that, to estimate the under-registration of the crisis death. So we have to attribute to the total excess mortality to the appropriate years, because this global estimation is for all the period, and also to distribute these deaths by sex and age if possible. So, but in the total, the 2.6 global mortality, excess mortality losses was partially registered. And we see that, we know that 1.7 was registered. So what? Zero point nine. Surprised by my stat. 0.9 have to be redistributed. They were not registered. Some of them was not registered, but affected to the normal period, and we estimated them to 0.4. And non-registered during the crisis were estimated to 0.5 about. and of which most of them, of course, are the year 1933. To distribute this by year, by single year of observation, we follow the excess mortality observed. Because we have a part of the mortality which is observed by registration. We can distinguish the normal part of that by using our model about normal mortality. And the difference is exceptional registered mortality. And we add the non-registered mortality according to the distribution to the exceptional registered mortality. Okay? And we do the same, almost the same, when we can do it for age. And for age, we have to distinguish the case of different period, of course. For the period 27 to 32, to 31, in fact, it is not a problem to distribute the underestimation, the unregistered deaths as the expected deaths, because nothing exceptional occurs in this time, at that time. But for the year 32, 33, 34, it is necessary to do differently because of the crisis. And fortunately, for the year 32, 34, we have statistics of deaths by age and sex for these 2 years, of course, incomplete. But once again, we can distinguish in these statistics of registered years, or registered deaths, what is normal mortality, what is exceptional mortality. And we can distribute the non-registered as the exceptional registered mortality. And we did that. For 32, we have not this opportunity because we have no data by age, but we did as for the previous year. And it's not a big problem because there are less of non-registered deaths. And doing that, we have to check if everything is okay, of course, because it is not necessarily the case. And when we compare, it is interesting here to compare this famine, and, but more generally, it is very interesting to compare Ukrainian famine of 33 to the last true famine in Europe in the time of, it was in Finland in 1868, I think. So we compare these two famines for our purposes here, and we saw that the excess mortality ratio by age is quite similar in Finland and in Ukraine for the adult ages, but quite different for the young ages. And this is probably not normal. Probably it is due to the fact that our hypothesis is not so good for the young people. And in particular, it is absolutely impossible that the Ukraine famine has no more consequences as the Finland famine on the babies. While there is a great difference at any other ages, that's not possible. So we thought that we made some mistake by our way to proceed, and we made a special correction for infant mortality and for young children mortality. And doing that, you can look at this graph. It's not perhaps not so clear, but you see that if we correct only infant mortality, we have these stars, varied stars. So we already corrected infant mortality there, and we get some acceptable infant mortality rate for Ukraine. But still there, it is not enough, and we have to correct also the rate at 1 and 4, 1 to 4. And we did, and we got the red line. So as the red line is our final estimation for mortality by age in 1933 in Ukraine, compared to the black line for Finland and to the blue line, which is Ukraine 2 years before. And then we can calculate, compute life tables, and calculate life expectancy. This is the mortality specific mortality rates, probability of death by age, for several years, the year 1933 in red, and the year before and the year after, 1932, 1931, 1934, 1935. And you can see that the 1933 is astonishingly higher. And in terms of life expectancy, the result is very, very shocking, because we got life expectancy at birth for the year 1933 of only 7.3 years for the boys and 10.9 years for the females. So it's a very, very, very exceptional mortality crisis. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. And Dr. Franz Mesle will pick up the story and carry it through the long-term demographic consequences.
Thank you. So I hope you are not too tired with all these numbers and figures, and I will go on, but maybe with some more simple exercise that we produced especially for this conference, when we were asked to say something about the long-term demographic consequences of the great famine. And then we thought that it would be interesting to try to estimate to see how would be the age pyramid of Ukraine in 2007 if there had not been this famine. So this was a starting point of our work. We thought also that to have a good idea of this impact, it would be interesting to compare it to the impact of other unfavorable events which have been lived by the Ukrainian people after the famine. And of course, at the first rank is World War II, but also some more demographic trends that we are interested in the most recent years. This is probably you know about the reversal in life expectancy trends which occurred since the mid-60s in Ukraine, like in other Eastern countries, and also the rather important decrease in fertility in the most recent years. So this paper was prepared with Jacques Vallin and with one of our Russian colleagues, Yevgeny Andreyev, who is a demographer, is now just at that moment working at the Max Planck Institute for Demographic Research in Germany. So the starting point, so this is almost where Jacques stopped. I mean, as he explained you, we estimated the global losses due to the 1933 famine by comparing the age pyramid of 1939 census to an hypothetical pyramid which would have been obtained if the famine hadn't existed. The total of the losses were estimated at 4.6 million, and you have here the distribution by sex and by age, with, of course, almost half of these losses relating to age less than 15, then 40% between 15 and 60, and the rest at age 60 plus. To see it more precisely by age this time, so in blue, everywhere in my graph, in blue, it will be the actual age pyramid. So this is the actual age pyramid in 1939. And in brown, orange brown, you can see the losses. So what would have been the, would be the expected pyramid without the famine in 1939? So you see that these losses are distributed rather regularly all along the pyramid. It's mainly due to the excess mortality. And then you have a rather, is it some pointer? Is it a pointer? Yes? Okay. And then here, this big hole is due in the same time to the birth deficit, which was especially important for the cohort born in 1934, and also, of course, the excess mortality of very young children, which occurred in 32 to 34. Then, starting from this point, so our question was, is it still possible to see remaining scar of this famine today? And as I told you, this question was a little complicated by the fact that the story of Ukraine was not very quiet during all this period, and that we had to deal with a lot of other disturbing events, as I already told you. But the first one I didn't yet speak was the problem of the territory changes, because the territory of Ukraine changed rather deeply from before and after World War II, and you have here in the territory in 1938, which is this bold line, and this is in this territory that was performed the 1939 census. But then in 1940, Ukraine annexed the western provinces, Volhynia and Galicia, as well as this south Bessarabia. Then there was a German occupation. I go rather quickly about that. But at the end of the war, the territory of Ukraine was much larger than it was before, and it was the 1940 territory, and even with a small piece more on of Ruthenia. And finally, in 1954, Crimea was transferred from Russia to Ukraine, and all the statistics now and all the age pyramid we produced are in this territory, and we had also to correct all the information to be consistent with this new territory. Then to come back to the World War II, it would be too long to explain you how we proceeded to estimate the losses due to the World War II, because I think it's even much more complicated than what Jacques already explained for the famine, but with the same assumptions, to try to project some hypothetical expected population without crisis, etc. Rather precise estimates of migrations, and this was much more difficult for this period, as you can imagine. We obtained some results. So for the people who are interested in, everything is written, is explained in the book Jacques spoke about, and also in a paper which was published in Population Studies in 2002, I think. But finally, the result of for World War II was first a fall trends in life expectancy that you can see here. And of course, there is a very big decrease in life expectancy, but this decrease is less important than the one that we found for the 1933 famine. You see that for males, we obtain a life expectancy at birth of 13.6 years in 1941, and for females, the minimum is in 1943, and is 20.6 years. You can also see the impact, we spoke of that yesterday, of the 1947 famine here, with a decrease of more than, or 11 years for males and 9 years for females. So a very important impact of World War II on life expectancy, but less important in intensity for 1 year than the famine, but of course, more important finally in terms of global losses, because it lasted 7 years if you included the 1947 starvation. And so the result that was what we estimated, the total losses due to World War II in Ukraine to 12.6 million people, of which 7.1 due to excess mortality. And these figures are to be compared to 4.6, of which 2.5 for excess mortality that we found for the famine of 1933. So this is the first unfavorable event, very unfavorable event to take in consideration. The second event that we wanted to discuss also was this dramatic divergence in life expectancy at birth, which occurred in Ukraine, but also in all the countries of the at least all the European countries of the former USSR, and also in most Central European countries since the mid-60s. So here you have the comparison with France. It's always easier for us to compare to France. And you can see that life expectancy, so I will not discuss this fluctuation, yes. But in any case, you can see that you have a decrease in life expectancy, really important, to be compared to the regular progression of life expectancy in France. But I could have chosen another Western country, you would have the same picture about. And so we decided also to see what would have happened on the age pyramid if this mortality has been just stable since mid-60s, or if progress had been comparable to the French ones. And the last demographic trends that we took in account was trends in the fertilities, total fertility rate, here with this very deep decrease since the beginning of the 90s. You see that this total fertility rate was about 2 children per woman at that time, and it was very close to 1 per woman at the end of the 90s. It's now increasing a little again. And again, so here, you have France here as a comparison, but we took only one hypothesis, would be what would have happened if there was had not been no fertility collapse and just some stagnation of the total fertility rate at the level of 1990. So the method is a very simple projection of the population. So starting to come back to the famine first, starting from the 1939 expected population without famine that we computed in our previous work, we made projections of the Ukrainian population until 2007 with very simple assumptions. So the people who died, who were not born because of the famine, would have had the same fertility and the same mortalities as the survivors, and the total net migration would have been the same. And here you can follow the pyramid. So this is the one I already showed you in the previous slide. And you can see how first this missing, especially this birth deficit here, is going more higher and higher in the pyramid. And also the consequence of this birth deficit, I think that there is some, yes, this is 1949 and this is 1959. Sorry, because I was just, so this is 1949, but let's take 1949. So you have the birth deficit due to the famine, which is also, of course, going higher and higher in the age pyramid. And then here you have the apparition. This is the birth deficit linked to the World War II. And if you look here in 1959, sorry, again, this birth deficit, and this birth deficit has a very big impact now on these new cohorts which arrive, because there are less mothers, less parents, and so there are less children who are able to be born. And of course, you have always the excess mortality, which is going up with the aging of the pyramid. And you can go like that until the last period, and here you have the 2007 pyramids, and you can see that on these pyramids there is still a lot of visible impact of the 1903 famine, which is much more regularly distributed over all the ages, but which is less which is far to be neglectable. But as I explained, and we can also look at that year by year and compare the population trajectories with and without famine. So the actual trends are here in blue. So this spike is due to the territory changes here, which brings a lot of additional population. But because of the terrible losses of the World War II, this additional population was canceled. The effect of this additional population was canceled very quickly. And then you have this regular progress of the population and this decrease in the most recent years, mainly due to the fall in fertility. And so you can compare these trends to the trends without famine. But now, if we want to compare to other events, as I told you, we repeated the same exercise after suppression of another event, so keeping everything as it was except the event we want to study, so these different events. And finally, and I will show you some examples, we propose different combinations, keeping some events and suppressing some others, to see all the possible ranges and different hypothetical evolution of the Ukrainian population. So first, let's compare the impact of these various events compared to the famine one. So I recall you, the actual population in 2007, 46.5 million. Without famine, 51.9. So it means still now population impact of 5.4 million due to the famine. Without World War II, the population would be 59.5. So a larger impact nowadays of this World War II, which is 13 million of people missing because of World War II. Then this hypothesis, different assumption about the mortality trend. So if the mortality had remained constant since 1965 in Ukraine, there would be almost 3 million people more in Ukraine now. And if the progress had been the same as in France, there would be 6.5 million more. And finally, no recent fertility collapse, so fertility constant since the beginning of the 90s, 3 million people more. Of course, these different losses are partially or completely compensated by the territory gains, which gives now still 11 million more people to Ukraine. Just another way to see always the same thing. So just looking at this trend, so again, these two that I already show you, the actual trends and without famine, but then you can look at what would could have been the trends of the Ukrainian population without any negative event. You can always dream, and without and with some favorable mortality trends. So the population of Ukraine could be almost 80 million people nowadays, and the contrary, the opposite assumption, I would say, is with everything as it occurred and with no territory gains, and then Ukraine would be 35 million, would have 35 million people now. But you can also imagine other combinations. So this one, it's without famine, no, and World War II, but with the recent unfavorable trends in mortality and infertility. And you see that you have this rather impressive decrease of the population. Or the last one I will show you is so if the life had been completely like a quiet river, we say in French. So from 26, you know, anything would have happened. Everything would have gone smoothly, and even no territory gains. You see that you will have had a very regular progression of the population, the Ukrainian population. And again, to show you the different to add all these effects on the same pyramids. Here is a 2007 pyramid of Ukraine, as it is actually estimated, and you can put on this pyramid the losses estimated due to the famine again, and that I already commented, and then you put the losses due to the World War II, and you can judge of the magnitude really of this event and how it is playing still how the impact is still very impressive in the most recent years. This is the losses due to the mortality reversal in the case of constant mortality. So you see that for the distribution by age, it's different from the other events because it's especially important at the oldest ages, at adult ages. And this is even more impressive if you compare to what would be the pyramid with the French trends in mortality. And you can see that in this case, the female losses are almost, at least at old ages, more important than male losses, because even if the trends in mortality were more unfavorable for males than for females in Ukraine, when you compare to a country where these trends were favorable, the difference is almost the same for males or for females, and this is the reason why you see this very big impact for females when comparing to French trends. And the last, of course, the last effect of the fertility decline, which is only focused on the most recent cohorts. And so the losses are just concerning the age below 15. So here, just to see all these different phenomenon, and so this would be the 80 million pyramid population of Ukraine. And just so some conclusion after this exercise, which could look at like little like a game, but I think which can allows us to have a better estimates of this impact, even this long-term impact. So what is sure is that the impact of this famine is still visible on the 2007 Ukrainian population. Now the remaining scars are mainly due to the 1933-34 birth deficit and its indirect consequences. Of course, the direct consequences of excess mortality are vanishing because of the progressive extinction of the generations which were already born in 1933. And the World War II's impact is more important nowadays, but famine's consequences, 75 years after the crisis, are comparable and even sometimes greater than to that of much more recent events like this mortality upturn or fertility collapse. And just to conclude, because I hope it will work, I have some movies for you, but I am not quite sure if you give me 1 minute. Because it doesn't run because the macro is now not authorized on this computer. I am sorry. So, but I just wanted to, it was some the annual variation of the pyramid from 1936 to nowadays, including all these changes. But if somebody knows how to make the macro working, but so that's all. We can see that after the break, maybe. Thank you very much.